Hello, and welcome to the Inside AVs podcast for August the 28th, 2020. This is episode number 21. Today, we'll be talking about driving the XPeng P7 Performance. Tesla tackles Pikes Peak with Model 3 Triple Threat. And Bollinger reveals its delivery van. I'm Dominic Chioni, Inside EV's editor and Inside EV's forum moderator. Joining us today, we have Tom Malogny, multiple EV owner and Inside EV's editor. We also have Martin Lee from the EV News Daily podcast, available on all your usual podcast platforms. And of course, we have Kyle Connor from the Out of Spec Motoring and One Lap YouTube channels. He also puts together the super awesome videos for the new Inside EV's YouTube channel. Go subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications. All right. So welcome, gentlemen of the panel and ladies and gentlemen of the audience. To kick things off, let's talk a bit about the trio of Tesla Model 3s at Pikes Peak this week, attempting to set a new record in, I believe, the exhibition class. Just to set the stage a bit, Pikes Peak is a mountain in Colorado in the U.S., 14,115 feet in height that crazy fast fools have been racing up since about 1916. That course is now completely paved and covers the last 12.42 miles. It has like 156 turns and ends at the very peak of Pikes Peak. So Kyle, you're there in Colorado, as we can see, if for all you YouTube watchers. He's on the mountain. He's got a beautiful cabin behind him. So you're there experiencing the glory that is the Pikes Peak International Hill Climb. Well, what's going on, man?
Oh man, it's been crazy in true racing spirit. We've had, you know, tons of drama, lots of crashes, cars going fast. It's been really super exciting, actually. And, you know, the thing with Pikes Peak that a lot of people don't realize, you think you just race in the middle of the day. No, you are on the mountain at 3 o'clock in the morning and you go until 10 a.m. and that's your day. So I am completely shot. We've been doing this for a week now and or almost a week, and we're nearing race day. So you have lots of practice ahead of time. You practice in sections. It's broken into a lower, middle, and top section. Different class of vehicles practice throughout the mountain, rotate through. And man, we've had lots of stories to share. I'm not quite sure where to start. I'll let you guys, maybe Dominic, if you want to prompt some questions, I'm happy to answer. But it's been a wild ride so far, and well, we aren't even at race day.
Well, we started out with three different Model 3s, and at the moment we're down to one. So let's start with like the first one, the first Model 3 that we lost. You had a video up. Oh, I think it was on one of your Out of Motoring, Out of Spec Motoring tweets, showing each of the three cars leaving the lower section for qualifying or for testing. And so we had all three at the very beginning. Then, so what happened to it was the Model 3 with all these crazy aero changes to the front end, right?
Right. So that was Josh Allen's car, and it's a Model 3 Performance, of course. They kind of took their own route. We didn't really know what to expect when they arrived at Pikes Peak, because they've been sort of radio silenced the last month or so on their build. So they showed up with this crazy aggressive aero kit, you know, kind of looked like it was just bolted together on a whim, but you know, apparently they were very confident in it. And it's Josh Allen's first time on the mountain, so he goes up on the first day of the first practice, wide open out of the gates, going up the hill. I can't remember if it was on his first or second run. I believe it was on his second run that he mistook. Again, this isn't from him. We haven't heard anything from their team, but in a very notorious spot for accidents, because it looks like another section of the hill where you keep your foot flat, except in this one, it's a hard break, and it was into the trees, stuffed the car straight in. Chassis is all bent. They could not open the doors, is what I hear. Again, a lot of this is hearsay, but even with manual releases, doors were locked in, so he had to get pulled out of the trunk. We just heard today he has four fractured vertebrae. Really not a good situation. Thankfully, it sounds like he's in good spirits, but they will not be running anymore. The other two cars are the Unplugged Performance Model 3, which is a ground-up built Basically one of their street performance packages that they're running here at Pikes Peak to prove that their performance products do work. They have Randy Pope's behind the wheel. First day went off amazing. They were super fast. Cars performing great. Everyone's pleased. And the way this exhibition class worked is, you know, we started first day on the bottom and the next day we went to the top of the hill. And what a lot of people don't realize is the top of the hill, because of the massive temperature changes, the road surface gets really heaved up. And so what's really nice and smooth at the bottom is the exact opposite up top. So first run out of the gate up top, you know, the car's set up really stiff. It's on coilovers, full Michelin slick tires. It's like 42 degrees, really cold up there. Randy gets on it off the line super hard. And we hear moments later, Randy stuffed it and, had a big off over a gully, spun the whole car around. And really, absolutely, an awful crash, truly, because your first run's always meant to be easy. It's a sighting lap. Like, take it, you're not setting any times this day. Right. The only qualifying that mattered was on the first day, and Randy blew everyone away, which was great. So this has been a real big topic of discussion around here. And I've been in contact with the Unplugged team. I've been with them every single day on this car. We examined it after the crash. We thought the chassis was bent, the battery was compromised. Turns out after we got the car on the lift and they started digging deeper into it, the chassis is not bent, the battery is intact, and the only things that are really ruined were the bolt in, bolt out front and rear subframes, the motor assembly, things like this, and suspension components. So what they did yesterday is they literally in the morning bought a Model 3 Performance. Tesla dropped it off at a body shop. They threw it on a lift, pulled all the parts off of it. And I was there at midnight last night and they were installing them into this car. And again, it's Friday today that we're recording this. Tomorrow we're off all day, no activities, and Sunday is race day. So I do believe this car will be ready for race day with some battle scars, but it really shouldn't be that much slower than it was originally. And Randy's very excited to get back in. And those are the two accidents and why we have one Model 3 left, which is Blake Fuller and the electric performance Model 3, which is right behind me actually. And it's looking great. And it's going to be an interesting ride here. Blake's going after a previous record that no longer exists, which is why he's in the exhibition class. And this is a stock production electric vehicle class. And so all he's done is strip out the interior, put on big, not even different brake size, but brake pads, brake fluid, and wheels and tires. They're allowed to change basically safety items, racing seat, roll cage. And this is what the car is doing here. Who you saw go by was Drew from Martian Wheels there. And of course, the car is running Martian Wheels. They're the best wheels for your Tesla, I think. And we'll see. Blake's going to have to keep it in one piece, get up the mountain, and he should beat his record, which is that he set in his Model S P90D back in 2016.
And so was that a 1028 or something?
I don't remember the exact time. I believe it was more than the 1028. I think it was 11 something. But the goal here is to get, right in that low 10 range. Randy's goal in that crazy modified unplugged performance is definitely to break the 10-minute barrier. So the cool thing is even though they're in the same class, they're not really competing. So everyone's been very friendly. All the teams, we've been intermingling, seeing what everyone else is doing, sharing best practices. It's been really a very competitive environment, but also a very friendly and, we're just trying to push the EV movement forward. And of course, I'm lucky I'm covering it, so I get to see all sides of the story. And it's all really positive. Unplugged, getting this car back together is certainly a miracle. And like I said, they found a body shop to stay open 24 hours of the day so that they can work inside and transfer all these parts. It's pretty wild. It's the true racing spirit.
So the modifications to the Unplugged Performance car, it has some aero bits on there and like a big wing on the back, and you have like wider tires and coilover suspension, but that's basically it though, right?
There's improvements to the cooling system on the car as well. Okay. So they're running three radiators. They're running, I believe, mm-hmm. I forget what gas, but it's very, you know, keep in mind, I've been running on little sleep, but basically a gas that they can spray onto the radiators and cool down the cooling system even more if they needed to. Okay. But thermals have been looking good. And yeah, it's big suspension, massive carbon ceramic brakes, and big aero.
Because they had finished qualifying, I think, on the first day. And so they had a lot faster. Were they ahead of everybody or just in the exhibition class?
So just in the exhibition class, because the open wheel cars are really fast. Oh, keep in mind, qualifying is not just about setting the fastest time. There is some sneaky logic behind it too. So Blake's goal was to qualify fourth slowest, and he qualified fifth slowest, but he was really close to that. And the reason is how they let the cars out on the grid. Blake's goal is to get out there on the start line and sort of be just out and ready to go so that the tires are the warmest, because keep in mind they're wrapped in these tire warmers to get the rubber nice and sticky. So there's a little bit more to qualifying than just going out and setting the fastest time. Blake definitely held back on the first day, and so it'll be interesting to see how he does on his final run. We have he has not yet done the full mountain full speed yet.
That's right. But he had I think it was 26 seconds ahead of the next second place vehicle in the exhibition class.
Right. Randy was absolutely flat out flying. No question. He was just on that
bottom section, 26 seconds. That's significant.
Oh, huge difference. I mean, that unplugged performance 3, I mean, you just watch that thing go by. And again, I was just feet away from it, and it looks like a missile going past. I've never seen an electric car perform as well as that vehicle did and does. And it's an amazing machine, no question. And Randy's a great driver. I think really the biggest mistake of that car was just going a little bit too hard on bumpy sections where that car had never been tested before. It's been tested on perfect racetracks. And of course the bottom section. So it's the first time it's seen bumps. Keep in mind that car only has 450 miles on it or something. It's purely a dedicated race car. And it's just a little bit too much too early, I think.
And those are the only electric vehicles on Pikes Peak this year?
Correct. The only electric cars this year are the 3 Tesla 3s. Now we're down to 2 for race day, it sounds like. For a while, though, when we thought that the unplugged car was torn up, chassis bent, we figured it was left to Blake. But now it's starting to get a little more exciting.
Right on. All right. Anybody else have some questions about Pikes Peak? No, we're good. Anything else you want to say, Kyle, about all that? Oh, did you get your donut?
Oh, what donut? Sorry, go ahead.
So at the very top of Pikes Peak, there's a little cafe sort of, souvenir shop.
Oh, I know what you mean. It's totally gone now. They're rebuilding a whole new building. The whole top of the mountain's been leveled, and they're putting up this beautiful glass thing. It's all construction and really nasty up there. Cool. But yeah, we went up to the top, and at Pikes Peak is just an interesting race, because not only just for the electrics, you really get the sense of it's you have some teams that are factory sponsored, for example, Acura's here with 3 vehicles, NSX and 2 TLXs. And then you have some guy that built a truck with a junkyard motor that's running it for probably less than a $5,000 team budget to do this thing. So it's really interesting. There's no barrier to entry, and it's a really amazing race and quite a sketchy road as well. I mean, I drove up it pretty quickly in my Model 3, not during the race, but just going up normally. And it takes a lot of mental capacity to figure that road out for sure.
All right. When I was there in 2015 when Monster Tajima was running that Rimac engineered car. And I drove it. I forget what kind of car I had, like some Toyota Econobox, not a Yaris, but anyway. I crept up that thing. Like I didn't bother trying to push or anything. And it was still, I was not in a... And I didn't feel like the need to speed up at all. I was crawling 20 miles an hour, and it's crazy drop offs everywhere. And it's such beautiful scenery too. Oh man.
It's amazing. It's beautiful. I'm reviewing a Toyota Avalon this week, a TRD, not an electric car. So nothing to really talk about, but I will not confirm or deny that the brakes were on fire at the bottom of the hill.
Yeah, definitely a lot of, it takes a lot of brake. It's good to have regenerative braking in that situation for sure. All righty. Well, this has been a pretty cool week. Someone else, Tom. So you've driven the the XPeng P7. And we have a review up, I believe, on a video up on Inside EVs right now. Want to tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, so XPeng brought a P7 to the U.S. for the first time that it's been here in the U.S. because the company was doing an IPO yesterday on the New York Stock Exchange. So, you know, they always want to bring a car to park it out in front of Wall Street so everybody can kind of ooh and ah over it. And the P7, for those that don't know, is the second vehicle from XPeng. They've been selling the G3, which is a compact all-electric SUV, for the last 2 years. It's done pretty well. And this is XPeng's second vehicle. Just launched it about 2 months ago. I think the end of June is when it started customer deliveries. And this car actually, you know, there's been a lot of cars out of China. You know, we talked about Kandi last week and whatnot, but this is really one of the first electric vehicles that people are really putting head to head against Tesla and saying, look, is this really a Tesla competitor? So when I got the opportunity to test drive it, of course, I jumped at it. And the cool thing about it was I was actually the first person to drive the car, the first person from the media, at least, to drive the car in North America. They rented out MetLife Stadium parking lot, which is only a couple miles from Wall Street. And I was able to really give the thing a run. I only wish Kyle was available. You know, if Kyle wasn't up at Pikes Peak, he would have been there with me because, you know, Kyle is our track guy. Kyle, you know, nobody knows the track like Kyle. He lives on a track, for crying out loud.
Yeah, they would have gotten that car back with no rubber left on those tires.
And you know what, Kyle? They would have been cool with that. They told me, have at it, do your best. I mean, I was, you know, I really thrashed the thing around as best as I could. I've got some short video clips of that, but not really good because I didn't have like a team there with me to help me do video. But I did get some video clips of that, and I got some good pictures of me driving it around. And, you know, I tell you, it's got a 400. This is the dual motor performance version. They have, just like the Model 3, they have a rear wheel drive version. That's the super long range version. Then they have an all wheel drive performance version. And that's what they brought. It's got 430 horsepower. It goes 0 to 60 in about 4.3 seconds. That's 0 to 62, actually, in 4.3 seconds. And, you know, it's meant to be their high-performance vehicle. And it was. It delivered on the promise. The thing really was able to handle the track well. I will note, and I note in the video, that it's definitely not tuned for the track. In China, the customers put a much bigger emphasis on comfort than they do on sport. They really don't have the opportunity to really thrash the cars around on roads, on country roads, as much as we do here and in Europe. So, you know, the comfort and luxury and comfort is absolutely premium. So the suspension was tuned more for comfort. As I was going over the bumps and the irregularities in the parking lot, it just absorbed them like, you know, absolutely fantastic. I didn't feel them. I'd be bouncing all over the place if I was in my Model 3. But at the same time, it couldn't take the cornering like my Model 3 could. It wasn't able to handle, say, the slalom like I could in the 3. There was more body roll. The brakes worked great. It has these big Brembo braking system, but I was able to get them to the ABS to lock up a little bit a few times on really hard cornering and braking. I mean, so, you know, it still kind of needs to be tuned a little bit. All that said, the user interface is fantastic on it. I couldn't read what it was saying. I had an XPeng representative there helping me because obviously it's all in Chinese, but it has a really great interior. I'm going to be doing another post coming up this week on Inside of Ease, where I really do a head-to-head comparison between the Model 3 and the P7 and really show more interior features and the user interface. I mean, you know, XPeng has in many ways copied things that Tesla has done. And, you know, imitation is the most sincere form of flattery. I don't really mind that. Tesla's done some things that are really good, and I wouldn't mind if more automakers copied what they did. I think Ford did to some extent with the Mach-E. They took some of the aspects of the things that Tesla was doing right, and they did their version of it. But I mean, for instance, there's an app store in the P7, and there's a video game, you know, a drag racing video game like I have in my Model 3, but it was actually better. It was more realistic, and it was high performance cars. It wasn't like the buggy video that you play in the Model 3. But as far as driving, I was super impressed with the car. At the price that they offer it, don't forget it has an 80.87 kilowatt hour battery pack. So it actually is rated in China at slightly longer range than the Model 3. So this is a long range, high performance vehicle. And it starts at about 32,000 US. Fully loaded, it goes up to 49,000. That's after the Chinese subsidies. So it costs a little bit less than the Model 3. And it's really right on par with it. As far as I'm concerned, it doesn't have the absolute, fit and finish of a legacy OEM. I think the Chinese brands still have a little ways to go with getting everything really up to snuff, but so does Tesla. Tesla doesn't have the best fit and finish, and people don't seem to mind that either. So I was super impressed. I mean, do you guys have any questions about the vehicle? It was, I think this would actually sell well if XPeng started bringing it to Europe and the US tomorrow.
Yeah, I see this as like a value play, you know, versus like a Tesla. So this is like, I guess the same size basically as the Model 3?
It's a little bit longer. It's about 6.5-7 inch longer. So it's, lengthwise, it's in between the S and the 3. But I think the interior space lines up with the 3 more. Because it's got this really long hood, that I think is really why it's longer.
What's that on the steering wheel?
The camera,
that kind of that's camera, around the top.
Yeah, it's a camera. Driver
is that
awareness.
A camera? What,
so
looking back at the driver?
Know, that's you know exactly. It monitors your awareness for when it's on their XPilot. Now it comes with right now XPilot 2.5. Which is, you know, XPeng's version of autopilot. And that's like a level 2 autonomous features. They're pretty close to being ready to launch their level 3, which is XPilot 3.0. That's supposed to launch in about 5 months. So XPeng just got approved in China to use level 3 autonomy. So this is supposed to have level 3 autonomy inside of 6 months.
Nice.
How many cameras on
14?
There's dotted everywhere.
14 exterior cameras.
Ooh, wow. And do they use any other? Do they use like LiDAR and stuff?
They have 17 exterior sensors also, in addition to the cameras. To be honest with you, I don't think they use LiDAR. They have radar, they have the ultrasonic 17 ultrasonic sensors and 14 cameras. Four of the cameras, I believe, are for the 360-degree surround vision, and the other 10 are, you know, for everything else. And you can actually take pictures from the cameras, from the user interface while you're driving or while you're parking. You can just take snapshots from different views of the cameras whenever you'd like.
Nice. This is the performance model, and you say it goes up to like 49,000. So, and it's 0 to 60 is like 4.5 seconds or 4.3 seconds?
4.3, yeah.
4.3. So the regular model, the Model 3 long range, not the performance, how does it compare? Is it like pretty much on par with that, like price and speed wise?
So, I have the Model 3 long range dual motor, and it goes 0 to 60, I think, in 4.3. Is it 4.4? Ka might even know. What's the long range dual motor Model 3, 0 to 60?
I don't know, but at this point, I'm sure it's very comparable.
It's very comparable. Yeah. It's within a tenth of a second to the regular non-performance, but this is their performance version. Right. So, you know, it isn't as fast as the Model 3 performance. But like I said, honestly, in a Chinese market, They put so much more of an emphasis on comfort and luxury that, you know, that they're not as dialed into the, oh, it's got to be 0.3 seconds faster, 0 to 60, like we are here. And to be honest with you, that makes a lot of sense because, you know, would you rather have a car that's a little, that's a lot more comfortable and, you know, 0.3 seconds faster to 60? I mean, most people other than Kyle would say, sure, give me the more comfortable car and I'll give up half a second on my 0 to 60 time. But the interior is super comfortable. It has a really cool driver's seat with built-in speakers in the headrest. And you can set it so that the navigation system only speaks through those speakers. So as you're driving and everybody's listening to music and the nav is giving you directions, you'll hear it, but nobody else will hear it. And you could also set it so that the music is only playing from your speakers. And if you set it not too loud, you'll hear the music just fine. And the other occupants in the car really don't hear anything. So it's a pretty neat system. It's got a lot of cool features.
Nice. So if you had a chance to buy this, would you buy like your long range Tesla or would you buy this performance version of it?
You know, it's hard to say. They both have really good advantages. Right. You know, and since it's a brand new vehicle coming out of the gate now, I'd like to have a little bit more of a track record. Let's say if it really was available right now, I'd definitely consider it. And I definitely will understand why, you know, in China, at least, this is going to be a direct Model 3 competitor because it offers a lot at a really good price. It does a lot of things better than what the Model 3 does. It does many things not as well as what the Model 3 does. So, you know, it offers an alternative to people that kind of like the Model 3 but want a car that's more luxurious, more comfortable, and, you know, offer some things that the Model 3 doesn't.
Is that your car next to it?
That's my Model 3, yeah.
I mean, nice. that's the thing is, you've driven your directly comparable car to the test drive, and you've got out of one car and into the other, so it's the perfect back-to-back.
It really is, yeah.
In terms of the connectivity, obviously this is an imported car, and it's very hard to judge, but what were they talking about in terms of 4G, 5G connection? And because that's, like with the Chinese cars, that's really the strength that they've got. It's that connected... Mm-hmm. Connects with their life and their world. And so were they talking about that? Things like Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, or, you know, Amazon support, because, you know, we have a bunch of, I won't say her word because it'll set everyone off watching, but, you know, we have a bunch of Amazon devices around the house, and it'd be great if I could walk out the house and get into the car and say, hey, A, you know, play my driving playlist. So connected cars are becoming, within the EV world, a bit of a point of difference, because obviously Tesla's never going to do CarPlay or Android Auto because they've got their own system. So did they talk about that?
Yeah, you know, not so much when I drove it, you know, during the IPO. But when I was over in China last year, when I got to drive in the G3, that was definitely a topic that they basically said that they want to be the most connected car company, you know, in China. Now, Byton told me that too, but, you know, Byton's no longer around, or actually they might be back. We're hearing recently that they might be back. But, you know, so yeah, they have a huge amount of apps that are already available in the car. Now, I don't know about Apple CarPlay or Android Auto. I think they have their Chinese version of that. You know, of that system that's what they use there. So, yeah, I mean, and it will obviously, be 5G connected if it's not already. I know that was something that they were working on. It's, you know, 5G is rolling out in China. You know, they're putting the towers up everywhere, or the repeaters, whatever exactly they're called. So yeah, I mean, it's absolutely going to be, you know, their goal is to be the most connected car company in China. They do over the air updates like Tesla does. They can pretty much update, you know, most of the features in the car. They talked about when the XPilot 3 is available. That'll be a simple over the air update. The hardware is already built into the car, and that they want to continuously update all of the autonomous driving features. And they said that's one of the reasons why they didn't go to a Mobileye per se, that they're developing their software in-house like Tesla does. And the XPeng reps told me, look, we don't want to rely on Mobileye or another company to push out an update where they test it forever and then they find something they're not happy with and they test it some more. They want to be able to totally control that. And instead of like pushing out a large update every 8 months or year or whatever, just as they improve things, just keep constantly pushing out updates. You know, again, I hate to keep going back to it, but like Tesla does. And customers like that. I personally like that. I like when I go out in my garage in the morning and it says, hey, you got an update. You know, I feel like, hey, you know, Tesla's thinking about me, you know, what's in today's update, and scroll down and, yeah, and see what's there. Which, by the way, no, we're talking about XPeng. In the latest update on my Model 3, they eliminated one of my biggest pet peeves. I know I'm not one of the people, I know this didn't bother everybody, but it really bothered me. The car, it used to lock when I pull in my garage, you know, walk away from the car. If you have it set to lock on departure, which you need to when you're in public, you know, it does it at home too. There was no way to separate that. So when I'd come out into the garage, I couldn't get in the car without my phone, or I couldn't unlock the charging port without my phone. It was so aggravating. I can't tell you how many times I walked into the garage and then I was like, oh, like, and I had to turn around and walk back into the house. In the last update, they eliminated that. Now you can turn that off when you're home. Oh, and nice. I am so happy when I go out in the garage and I have to get something out of the back seat, or I want to unplug the car and my phone's like upstairs charging in my office. It's just so nice. Thank you, Tesla, for doing that for me. But little things like that is what XPeng wants to be able to do. And for their automatic driving systems, they don't want to rely on a Mobileye or somebody else to say, okay, now you can have this update.
So really quick, XPeng has some sort of international ambitions. I know they're planning on going to Europe. Are they planning on coming here? And if so, what, a couple of years?
So, yeah, both, you know, they've made a lot of suggestions about Europe. I don't think there's been anything official that we're coming to Europe in this time frame or whatever. And they're kind of like that with the U.S. They have their sights set on international distribution, but they won't commit to saying, yeah, we're going to do this by then or we're going to do that by then. But it's pretty clear to me, and I've spent a lot of time with the company, they think they can compete on the global stage. I happen to agree with that. Now I've been in both of their cars. I've driven in their two vehicles. These are pretty high quality vehicles that deliver really good driving range, that have excellent, driver assistance systems. And, I absolutely think that if they're able to figure out a way to do the distribution, that they can compete on the world stage.
Right on.
I have one issue with this XPeng P7, which is that it's not as cool as their G3, because their G3 has this little hat on the roof. I don't know if you're familiar. Mm-hmm. And the main purpose of this hat is not for driver assistance. It pops up out of the roof with a camera and it follows you as you get out of the car with hand gestures, and it can take pictures of you. And the P7 doesn't have the selfie cam. Yeah. So I'd have to get the G3 if it comes internationally, because, you know, I would be selfieing everywhere with that thing on the roof. It is the silliest feature ever put on a car. There you go. You give up, I'm sure, quite a bit of efficiency so you can take pictures of yourself going to dinner.
I agree. It's really cool. But maybe, you know, since the P7 has these 14 cameras, I'm thinking you might be able to control them with like your smartphone app. So you might be able to walk out of the car, pull it up and take a picture
and get 14 from your app.
Exactly. So it won't follow you. But with 14 cameras, I'm sure you could find one that's facing you.
Right.
Love it.
Right on. All right. Well, let's get in some other news for the week. Bollinger, we haven't heard from them for a while. They've revealed their Deliver E van. It says, Bollinger says it's a B1 and B2 pickup and SUV will only deliver in late 2021, but it's now added a third vehicle in a completely different segment to its lineup of future vehicles. So behold the Deliver E. And that's the word deliver with a dash E at the end. Kind of clever. It's a modern looking panel van type vehicle, similar in some respects to the UPS Brown truck. It does seem to be sit pretty low and has a wicked long overhang behind the rear wheels, though. It's kind of makes me scratch my head thinking about, you know, going up steep driveways or just it's a really low and long overhang. It's kind of, I don't know, a little tricky. But anyway, it comes with a surprising 5 different battery size options, 70 kilowatt hour, 105 kilowatt hour, 140 kilowatt hour, 175 kilowatt hour, and 210 kilowatt hour. We don't know what the range would be on those, but I could, I would expect you could probably get, at least 250, 300 miles out of 210 kilowatt hour pack. But yeah. Oh, and there's one more significant piece to this news. The van and the B1 and B2 will be manufactured by another company in the Midwest. So any bets on who that's going to be? Anyone?
I have no idea. I don't know. I don't know who they would get to make this. I'll say this and then I will run away and you can tell me off for saying it. And Bollinger can email me and say you're completely wrong. This seems to me the kind of thing that a company does when they're looking to raise money and finance. This right. is a really lovely set of renders. There's another very loud company out there at the moment who we won't mention that have very nice renders and will go on any podcast that you want, but aren't actually making anything. Let's get,
and we'll see you afterwards.
let's get the trucks, which were announced last year, and we've very few people work for the company, not enough people to get the car, certainly produced, unless somebody else is going to make it for them. Let's get them going. And then let's talk about trucks, because these are just lovely pictures, but they're nothing more. And we haven't heard I haven't heard yet the finance behind it. I'm sure they're going to make an announcement at some point. But you know what? Well, good luck. Good luck to them. But this, it's renders and numbers. Like, here are the battery pack sizes. You haven't got a vehicle yet. Like, by the way, guys, I'm making an EV and it's got a 500 kilowatt hour battery pack. And goes for 4 weeks without being charged. So
great, you have an unlimited checkbook. Here you go.
send me your money now. So hey, look, you can then everyone watching can now tell me off for saying that and say I'm far too harsh on them.
No, I mean it's a fair point. I mean, they have a couple of vehicles that we've wanted to see them come, and instead of getting the vehicles, we have renders of a future vehicle. If you go to the Inside EVs article on it's Bollinger reveals delivery e-van. Diversify offerings before delivering. But it does mention something. I haven't been able to track it down exactly yet, but there is something about money coming together for them. So good. I'm hoping that's good. Not going to be the limiting factor for them, because I personally, I like what they're doing.
I was just at their offices in California, and it's a really nice small group of people that are really wanting to make cool products. And, vans aren't sexy. Delivery vans aren't sexy, but they're so needed. Right. Maybe to me. Actually, I love vans and trucks and stuff like this. But I was sitting in a parking lot today watching everyone tow up their race cars with these big lifted sprinter vans that are so cool, but I won't buy one because it doesn't run on batteries. And I'm just something like this. That's a work van. That's an adventure van. And this could be a platform to set a lot of those various use cases. And no one's done a really good job of it yet. And so this might be their niche and it might be their way forward.
Like this platform with an RV body on and a weekend leisure pursuits and getaways. It's a smaller market, but there's a market for stuff like that. So this could be where they can make some money.
That market's huge this year for some reason. This is the RV. Maybe it's the pandemic situation.
Well, yeah, everyone's buying RVs. They're flying off the shelf. You can't find them. Used ones cost more than new ones. It's insane.
Right, because you don't have to stay in a hotel, right? You can stay in your van. You're isolated somewhat, reducing your risk.
Yeah, absolutely. And, I'm kind of with Martin. We need electric delivery vans. It's such a huge market for them right now, and it makes so much sense. So many of these delivery vans have like set routes where they don't drive 150, 200 miles. I don't know if you need the 200 and 10, you know, kilowatt hour battery pack, at least to start off with. I have friends that own businesses that have a fleets of delivery vans. One's an ice cream distributor. And, you know, they almost never drive 100 miles in a day, and they make a whole bunch of stops. And an electric delivery van would be fantastic for them. So, you know, the market is there. Is Bollinger going to be the company that brings it to us first? You know, I'm not rooting against them, but, you know, enough with the renderings and, you know, what are we going to see next? And a semi, you know, from them, you know, start producing something. Then we can get a little bit, a little excited about you, you know?
Yeah. The thing that I like about this rendering and what I don't like, it's the same thing. It's got like nice rounded, you know, streamlined looking edges, and it looks, you know, it looks pretty nice. But if you look at the Bollinger vehicles, you know, they're square and they're very proud of their squareness. And, you know, it's just like it, but it, you know, it's not being carried over into this design at all. So it's kind of interesting. Yeah. But we do need more trucks. I think 200 miles is plenty for like a daytime delivery route. So yeah, they might not need the big 210 kilowatt hour battery pack, because you don't really drive these on the interstates for any length of time, maybe between exits or something. But yeah, so the only companies I can think of Midwest that could manufacture for them would be Rivian, which would be kind of strange because, you know, Rivian is building their own panel van, so I would kind of rule them out. And then there's Workhorse in Ohio, Lordstown, Ohio. And they make not the Badger, that's Nikola. What's the Lordstown Motors pickup truck name?
Yeah, the Workhorse.
Is that what it is? Okay.
Yeah, the hub motor Workhorse one. Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
It's so interesting. You know, this has worked throughout time in automaking, having somebody else make your EV. And then Lucid said only last week in an interview that it was not the point of the interview, but it was part of it, which was, would you make somebody else's EV? And they were saying, no, absolutely not. It's a mad business model to be making other people's electric cars for them. So, you know, and I rate what Lucid are doing. So, you know, it's an interesting one. It's right. maybe it's the best way forward. Maybe it's not. It's not something that has held many people back over the years, but we've talked about on the, you know, companies like Magna make the I-Pace and many other cars, and it works well for them. So
there's an outfit called Valmet, I believe, that made the original Fisker, and I believe they were back in the news just recently. They have something going on, so they might be seeing some more contract manufacturing from them, but I don't believe they're in the Midwest. So yeah, that still leaves me wondering who Bollinger is teamed up with here. Yeah. So let's move along. Elon Musk this week said that 400 watt hour per kilogram battery cells are likely in just 3 or 4 years. That's kind of geeky maybe, but just stick with us here. So on Monday, Elon Musk responded to a tweet from Sam Corse from an investment firm, ARK Invest. That company is extremely bullish on Tesla. It asks, why does Musk keep hinting at his excitement for an electric jet? In the past, he has said that electric flight starts to get interesting once you hit 400 watt hours per kilogram. And then Elon responded with a tweet of his own, saying that 400 watt hours per kilogram with high cycle life produced in volume, not just in a lab, is not far off, probably 3 to 4 years. So right now, cell energy density is about 260 watt hours per kilogram. 400 watt hours per kilogram would be a huge improvement that could make maybe some electric airplanes viable. It would also do a lot for the EVs that we have now, either by expanding their range with bigger batteries in the same space or just reducing the weight of the packs, which, you know, improves handling dynamics. It would improve quickness. It would also boost range a little bit. And if the materials don't involve some exotic elements, the cost of cells could drop because, you know, fewer raw materials are needed per given watt hour of energy storage ability. So how transformative do we think this might be? And is this the final tipping point for electrification? Martin, do you have some thoughts on this?
Yeah, you know, look, so the big thing is Tesla's battery day, and there's a few things playing into this. So 22nd September, stock price has gone through the roof for various reasons. But one of the reasons is the excitement. So maybe people are buying the news, and maybe they'll, or whatever that phrase is, and they'll sell after when they realize that Tesla is not reinventing the battery cell here. But I think Elon is starting to play down battery day just in the last couple of days. He's the first one, obviously, that will quite happily use Twitter to do the promotion that he wants to do and to, you know, to whip things up into a frenzy. Last couple of days, I've just seen, so by saying this kind of technology is 3 to 4 years away, well, he does still have to be careful what he says on Twitter. They're still a publicly traded company. So they can't come out on 22nd of September and say, oh, by the way, we did it 3 to 4 years early. So this isn't the technology they're going to release then. So I think lots of people are expecting some revolutionary announcement on the 22nd, and it's going to be exciting, and it's going to be the path for Tesla over the next few years as a business, as an energy business, as a car business as well. But this isn't going to be it on battery day. And so I think he's just damping down some of the excitement on that and joining in with that kind of that conversation, being part of the conversation, but not whipping people up into as much of a frenzy. So I think that's where he's saying 3 to 4 years away, and not saying, because he could have replied, oh, you know, you never know, maybe that's what we've got up our sleeves. And I think so many people now are expecting the battery day is going to be this revolutionary technology, look like they're going to unveil something amazing, and then everyone's going to feel let down. So I think that's what he's doing with this tweet. And sure, I mean, this technology probably is 3 to 4 years away. It involves, from what I understand, there's been some various stories about a company moving opposite from Cato Road, or where Tesla are, and he's dampened that down and said, hey, no, we're not doing business. He's actually said today, we're not doing business with them, but good luck to them. They just happen to be near us. And that is all to do with silicon inside the cell and controlling it. And that's what this company's expertise is in. And so, from my understanding, that these big advances in energy density can come with things like that. I think it's to do with using silicon on the anode and making it reliable, not just work in the lab. So that's why this technology isn't here today, and it's a few years away, from what I understand. So, Dom, you may be muted. There you go.
There we go. So yeah, we lost Kyle there. Apparently, it's raining in Colorado now on the mountain. Weather is crazy there, especially when you get in the altitudes. So we'll have to carry on for a while like this.
He could have just put an umbrella up and carried on with this podcast, but no, he's gone to find cover. Unbelievable.
Right, but he's got a battery issue too, I guess. So
okay. Well, yeah, he's got to keep himself dry. He'll be back.
So with regard to this, with battery day, so I'm expecting to, you know, there'll be some sort of product announcement or technology announcement. They're going to maybe use this dry electro technique or something. But really, I want to see I expect to see a roadmap to this 400 watt-hour per kilogram cell. And because that's a really short period of time, 3 or 4 years. We've had lithium cars since the first part of the 2000s. I think the Nissan had a small hatch wagon thing that was the first to have the lithium cells. But there hasn't been a huge improvement in energy density over this time. It's 5% a year or something. So this is a kind of a big jump over a short period of time.
Yeah, but so 3 to 4 years means it's working in the lab right now.
Yeah.
So for him to say 3 to 4 years, it means someone's got it working somewhere.
Yeah, they have some level of confidence. Yeah.
It's just not ready.
Well, you do have to factor in Musk years, you know. So, you know, 3 to 4 years doesn't always turn out to be 3 to 4 years. You know, most of the people that I've talked to from different manufacturers and seem to think that the 300 watt hour per kilogram around the middle of this decade is attainable, you know, which would be the 3 to 4 years, somewhere around there. And that, you know, the 400 watt hour per kilogram probably isn't going to happen till, you know, close to the end of the decade. Now, you know, the timeline could be accelerated. But, you know, as Elon's always very optimistic, and he even admits that, you know, sometimes he's off with his timing because he's super optimistic. That is you know, as mentioned, the Holy Grail, 400 watt hour per kilogram, opens up, you know, as we were talking about before, not just for automotive use. That will open up, you know, energy storage for a lot of things where it's just currently not viable, like aviation. So, I mean, you know, that would be fantastic if we will get there. But whether we get to that in this decade, I think, is still up for debate. Yeah. I'd love to see it in 3 to 4 years. But I kind of think that if we're still doing this podcast in 2024, we're not going to be talking about driving cars with 400 watt hour per kilogram just yet. But, you know, I'm not a battery expert. No. I just like to talk about this stuff.
I think battery day is more likely to be, as Tom said, the roadmap of where they're going. So the next 3 to 5 years, which is going to be exciting, because it's going to allow things like Roadster and Tesla Semi. But I think it's going to be more about, because Elon is going on about engineering more and more, and come and work for us, and if you're a great engineer. And I think battery day is going to be more about how they're going to do it. So you've got the Maxwell acquisition, which is definitely going to be a big part of that, like you say, with the dry electrode. You've got the Hybar acquisition, which largely went under the radar, the Canadian company they bought a year ago, which are experts in how to actually make the cells. They're a production company. Of course, you've got Grohmann in Germany, that are a hardcore engineering company as well, which Tesla bought many years ago. So I think battery day is more going to be like, hey, we've worked out how to make our own cells quicker than everybody else. And so that has a load of advantages, and that'll be very, very exciting. But it's not going to be Elon announcing flying cars on the 22nd.
No flying cars. Yeah.
Damn!
But I prefer
sell
to
all
stay-
your shares, sell them!
I prefer to stay naively optimistic. So I'm going for 3 years, Tom. We'll bet some donuts on this or something.
I will take that bet. 3 years?
Yeah. Because
I will take that bet.
Because he has been really bad about timelines in the past, it's true. But then, on the other hand, they've kind of flipped that script a little bit, like with the building of the Chinese Gigafactory. And now we look at the progress of the Austin Gigafactory and Berlin, especially building a Gigafactory in Germany, where they have all kinds of red tape in the EU. You know, the continent's kind of famous for its red tape, the EU, right?
They've accomplished a tremendous amount. I'm certainly not taking anything away from Tesla, but building factories at an accelerated pace is different than, you know, engineering new technology. You know, things that just... You can't rush certain things. You know, you can't rush construction. You can, you know, there's a lot of things you can do with getting permits fast-tracked, with just putting more employees on, having super aggressive, you know, schedules. But, you know, when you're coming to bringing something to market, inventing something that's new, it's a different ball game. It's kind of like, you know, we're talking about the COVID-19 vaccine, you know, and, oh, we'll have it in 3 months and we'll have it in 6 months. You know, maybe we will. We might get lucky, but that's, you know, not typically what happens. So we hope we have one fast. And I hope we get to 400 watt hour per kilogram, you know, in 3 years. I'd love to be wrong on this one, but my guess is you'll be paying up in 3 years.
Right. But that would be so great for, like, electric bicycles or motorcycles. Mm-hmm. Man, like motorcycles, everything. Is like the electric motorcycles, such a packaging challenge, you know, the way things are. And this would just make, wow.
Dom, I still think the big thing is aviation.
That's
the biggest thing. If we get that level of energy density, it makes sense to build electric jets and planes. I mean, that, you know, talk about, you know, really reducing our carbon footprint, you know, get carbon out of aviation.
Right.
Yeah, completely.
Man. Right on. So our next item talks about, it's a Lucid Air. So this week we heard from Lucid again, ahead of the reveal of its Air sedan. Last week we learned it could go 517 miles on the EPA test, and that it also could charge, I think it was 300 miles in 20 minutes. So this week, among other things, we learned how big the battery is that can do all this stuff. So, Tom, how big is the battery in the Lucid Air? And can we now say it's more efficient than the current Model S?
Well, we don't have official EPA range ratings, although right. Lucid said they had it tested by a third party. It will be if things hold true. So the only thing we had heard from Tesla from Lucid up until now was that the battery pack was less than 130 kilowatt hour. So most people, including myself, said, okay, it's 128 kilowatt hour. You know, it's less than 130. We found out this week it's 113 kilowatt hour. Now, that's an incredible feat to be able to deliver 517 miles, EPA range rated miles, with 113 kilowatt hour battery pack. Amazing level of efficiency when you consider that, the new Model S now has 100 kilowatt hour battery pack, and it's rated at, is it 402, I think, 402, 403. So, you know, you're talking about an extra 13 kilowatt hour adding over 100 more miles. So yeah, it's pretty significant. Now, Lucid had been telling us that they're striving for efficiency and it's going to be the most efficient vehicle, but now we're starting to see the numbers. I haven't been able to confirm if the 113 kilowatt hour is the gross size of the pack or the usable side of the pack. I've asked Lucid that direct question and they said they're not releasing it at this moment. So, you know, that's going to affect to some extent exactly how efficient it is. But still in all, amazing level of efficiency. This is what we need EV manufacturers to really focus on, being, you know, high performance, but also super efficient. And this car is going to be an efficient car.
Right. So if we put the EPA numbers aside and just go, so Lucid did it like a road test. They filled up the Lucid Air and a Tesla Model S and a Porsche Taycan, filled the batteries up the top and drove them down the road. So the Lucid Air completed 456 miles and the Tesla Model S did 355 miles. So there's like 100 miles difference basically. And there's maybe only like 13 or so kilowatt hours difference between them. So that does tell us that, you know, as efficient as the Tesla Model S is, which, you know, it's extremely efficient, like 402 miles on the EPA range test is like crazy. And 355 miles in real life testing is outstanding. But 456 miles with just, you know, another 13 or 14, whatever kilowatt hours of battery, that's incredible. What are your thoughts on this, Martin?
Yeah, this is, we've known that they are focusing on their efficiency side for a while, but this is, and again, we get the reveal on the 9th of September. This is just more evidence to point towards the fact that this is where they've really spent their time and attention. So they've gone, right, we can make the car, and they put a Twitter video up. Let me display that. There we go. Earlier today, which I just clipped out, but they've really gone big on, let's make the motors as small as possible. Let's get those drive units down to maximize passenger space.
Right.
They have, as you can see in the back, they've left a space in the skateboard design of the pack, which is where the feet of the rear passengers go. And so again, just making a bit like the Taycan did as well,
yes,
rather than just being completely solid, but just finding these ways to fit people in, but also have a spacious car, huge boot, trunk on that,
and too, right?
Yeah, and just a very, very well engineered, efficient car. So super excited about finding out more on the 9th because it looks great. Looks great. Can't wait. Let's get the details. I'm tempted to believe it's 120 kilowatt hour pack with 113 usable, but reserving seven for the buffer at the top and bottom seems excessive for how much they would need. So maybe I'm wrong on that.
Right.
And as far as the frunk, you mentioned the frunk. Right. Sorry to cut you off, Dom.
No.
It is the largest frunk on any electric vehicle. It's actually 90% larger than Tesla's on the Model S. So it's a huge frunk in the front. And that's what they're really pushing, the fact that
Their efficiency that they're striving for isn't just drivetrain and range, it's efficient space management, where the interior of the vehicle has the most efficient layout. That's really part of what, Lucid is pushing, that, you know, their efficiency doesn't end with powertrain. It's every aspect of the vehicle has been optimized to be efficient for what it does.
Yeah, like we were saying, because it's a startup company, it's like a new automaker, to really make a splash, it has to have like strong product. And it looks like they're really pursuing every possible angle they can, like product-wise, like, you know, power, range, speed. I bet you the handling is going to be great. I can't wait to see more about that. And like the latest thing with this, with the space inside. Yeah, and that's a huge frunk. I don't know. I can't wait to see how they've done that. I'm like trying to picture in my head. I saw the Rivian R1T frunk, and it was huge. Mm-hmm. And the Mustang Mach-E has a huge frunk that the Ford engineers like to fill up with shrimp. But that's right. Anyway, let's move along. Running low on time. So real quickly, the next VW Passat for Europe will get a full electric variant, and it arrives in 2023. That's a little odd. Not every electric Volkswagen in the future is part of the ID family, it seems. The German automaker has announced that we'll get this electric variant of the Passat, which strikes me as a little odd that they're going to build an EV not based on the MEB platform.
Because they've got to squeeze batteries into places where batteries aren't meant to go. It's a little weird. I can understand the plug-ins, what they call it, and the GTE. I think they're kind of moving to the phrase e-hybrid and then GTE for Golfs and Passats. And that makes a lot of sense, because for those not ready for full EV, the Passat is great, the Golf is great. But to go full electric is really surprising. I'm not sure they'll do this.
Well, this is they're going to use the modular longitudinal matrix platform, or the MQB, which is a mouthful, but it's the MQB platform, which is what the Audi e-tron is on now. So it already has been. It's going to be a modern, updated version of that platform. So maybe even better equipped to handle like electric variants, because that's the future. It's just surprising to me that they're keeping this platform around for electric. So when they have the MEB platform, they also have like the J1 that the Taycan sits on that it can use, and the Audi has a car coming on that as well. And then there's the PPE? There's another like a larger platform that's also, electric in the Volkswagen group that's going to be coming out. Eventually we'll probably see like large SUVs on that, but there's nothing really been announced about that yet. So it's just a surprising bit of news. Passat numbers they sold really high in the early part of the decade. They're like over 100,000 a year for like 2012, 2013. And now there were 14,000 in the US last year. So that's a huge plunge. And they really, I guess the next Passat will be more utilitarian. So we might see a hatch or maybe even a wagon-esque type of vehicle. But yeah. So another really quick bit of news. Before we close out, Porsche has postponed its Taycan Cross Turismo until early 2021, which is okay. I can deal with that. That's the long roof, like a station wagon looking, kind of slightly lifted version of the Taycan, which I really like. I kind of prefer it, sort of. Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, it looks great, doesn't it? Like if you're watching the YouTube version of the podcast, it just. It does look great. This is the old Mission E photos, which is still a great name for an EV. It does look good. Not surprised they've delayed it. They've upgraded the Taycan through the year, and they've had some good news for customers, and they're bringing updates to it. So making people wait till 21, not a huge problem for me on this.
Hey, so do you know how to pronounce the name of this Lotus supercar?
The Evija.
Evija? Oh, thank you. I would have pronounced so wrong. I'm glad I asked.
Lotus are a company from Norfolk, the county of Norfolk, which is where I'm from. So Lotus being based in Hethel and the history of Lotus. Right. Not that I ever knew anyone that worked in the factory, but obviously, very proud of growing up near the factory. So I take a keen interest in all things Lotus.
Sweet. Well, I just mentioned that because they're... how do you say that?
Evija.
I want to say Ja for some reason. Evija. It's delayed because of COVID. It's now coming in the first half of 2021 instead of late 2020. But the output has been increased to over 2,000 horsepower. So that's kind of a plus. This is actually a pretty incredible car. I saw some numbers on it, and it's just kind of, this is actually kind of more interesting than thought. And in the styling, that's, you know, subjective, but I kind of like it. They missed out on like 5 months of road testing, including like hot weather testing in Spain because of all the COVID shutdowns and inability to move, you know, through different countries. And it's a low volume car, 130 units, between 1.77, 2.36 million US kind of dollar level, which is just out of my budget. And if I did have
that's a shame.
If I did have that budget, I'd probably lean towards Rory Max just because, you know, I like Mate a lot. And
yeah.
And if anyone has a chance to look back on YouTube at the Rimac YouTube channel, they did a nice little Monday. They usually release a video on many Mondays, and this past Monday they talk about the monocoque that's Benissi concept 2, and it's just a really special design. It does there's been lots of monocoques before in the past, but this one has the integration points for the front and rear suspension inside the, usually that attaches, all that stuff attaches to the monocoque, but this is like, it goes over that, you know, you attach your suspension parts to the monocoque, you're not attaching subframes to it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it just holds a special place in my part. Plus they tease that there could be a concept 2 roadster, which hasn't been mentioned in the news anywhere. So if you're watching this, you might have heard it here first.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Anyway. You can take the Rimac. I'll take the Lotus Evija. Okay. And we can catch up sometime with our multi-million dollar supercar. I don't know what either of them cost.
Tom, before we close out here, what all electric supercar would you take given the chance?
Does it count as a supercar, the new Roadster? I mean, yes. I just think that's, you know, going to be, you know, just amazing vehicle. So I'd probably stick with Tesla.
Sure.
Well, that makes sense. Why not? You can put it in your app with all the your other cars. It makes sense as well. It's convenient.
Yeah, so. I don't need the real crazy flashy looking vehicles. Honestly, I think the Roadster is kind of like, it's out there. It's sporty. It looks really cool, but it's not like, oh, look at me, you know, driving down the road that you get with some of the other, say, supercars. You know, that never really was my thing.
Yeah, on the Evija, they focused on the 0-300 kilometer per hour time, which is 186 miles an hour, which, by the way, is 9 seconds. But when you're focusing on that, probably not going to be that great on the road to go get a pint of milk because you ran out.
nine seconds. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I do like the subdued, compared to supercars, the subdued styling of the Tesla Roadster. That is pretty nice, I gotta say. Yeah. And actually, this is not in the news yet either, but Nico Rosberg is the first Concept 2 customer that we know of. So he's a Formula F1 racing champion, and he won the series, and he retired from racing right after that top. He's a great guy. He has a nice YouTube channel, and he does a lot of electric, different electric things. He had an electric motorcycle, Energica, that I think he just auctioned off for charity, but yeah. So that's another little piece of news that you might have only heard here. So that brings us to the end of our show. I'd like to thank you all for joining us. If you have any comments about any of the topics on today's show, you can comment on the Inside EVs podcast post, the YouTube comments section, or on the Inside EVs forum podcast thread. Don't forget, you can find and follow all of our panelists on Twitter. Tom is at TomLog. Martin is at EV News Daily. Kyle is at Out of Spec, and I'm at Dominic_Y. Click subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications, and we'll see you all next week. Ciao.